seated. Good. So, the stethoscope ceremony. This is one of our favorite events of the year. And I just thought I would let you guys know, especially you second year students, you know, where the tradition began. And it actually began in 2008. That was the first year that we had second year students getting ready to go off the clinical. And if you do the math, and I know if you guys are all good at math, that makes this year the 15th annual stethoscope ceremony. So in our busy schedules, to just pause. It gives us a moment to gather together, almost all in person, and to celebrate. So we get to celebrate our second year students, we get to celebrate our award-winning graduates. And you know what, this year we have so much to celebrate. In fact, we were still adding awards last night. So it's wonderful, it's really, really great. We couldn't be more proud of you guys, our students, our recent grads. And we recognize that as a program, we are a little bit spoiled. We know that. You know that too, right? But and the reason that we're spoiled is because we have such dedicated students. You guys are here to learn. You're ready. Yeah, you're ready to come and find answers to your questions. You seek out new and interesting opportunities, and you're accomplishing great things. So, you know, we know how lucky that we are. And for you folks at home, I'm sure that you, as family and friends, have watched what has happened over the past 2 years. These guys work hard. We know that, and we appreciate it. You have embraced what it means to be a respiratory therapist. You are problem solvers. You are technical experts. You're collaborators. You're patient advocates. We appreciate, you appreciate, as do we, you appreciate and you are challenged by the unpredictability of our profession. You've endured 2 years of remote learning, changing pandemic restrictions, limited in-person opportunities, and managed to make it through Gino's GT final. Accepted change, and you've been patient with your faculty who sometimes are navigating these challenges right along beside you. You dug in your heels and you worked hard. You got the job done. Here you are, getting ready to go off to clinical. You know what? And you even found a little bit of time to have fun. So that's good too. You've done an exceptional job at creating and maintaining a sense of community amongst your peers. And I think it's important to mention, especially for those of you at home, that this group of students, they're gathering together as a group, but the first opportunity that they had to actually be together as one group was only in March of this year, right? And thankfully, I had the opportunity, I was the privileged one to have you for your first class. So for those of you at home, I had, you know, sort of arranged a little icebreaker activity just so that they could, you know, have a little chat with one another. And I thought, you know, I'll just allot maybe about 20 minutes for that activity. And you guys took it for an entire hour. So important and how happy you were to just be together. So we commend you for your efforts to connect with one another. And you've established yourself as a team, even through all of these challenging conditions. I encourage you to keep doing this. Connect with one another when you're in clinical. Stay with your family and friends. You know, make sure you're connecting with them as well. And don't forget us, because once you leave and you go off to clinical, then we just sit here and we're lonely and we want you to tell us what you're doing. So, you know, don't be afraid to email us and just let us know what's going on. Okay, our job might be unpredictable, but one thing is certain, and that is that you have chosen a field that makes a difference in the lives of so many. Be proud of who you are, be proud of what you're doing, and know that we are very proud of you too. So, now I'm going to hand the virtual microphone off to Dr. Varani Bhaskar, and Varani is our Executive Dean of Health and Life Sciences. She has a few words she'd like to say to you. Welcome, Varani.
Thank you, Pam, and hello, everyone. Great to see so much red in the room. It's my distinct honor to welcome you all to the Respiratory Therapy Stethoscope Ceremony, a very exciting event. And if I see correctly, I think there is some nice treats behind Pam on. Yes, I was thinking that. That is lovely. And in red as well. So for those of us at home, we'll just have to buy some red strawberry pie and just have it ourselves once we have these brand new RTs back with us and have something to celebrate. But all kidding aside, I know all of us have really looked forward to this date. All of us in any shape or form have committed and presented a lot of support and work into coming to this point. And so I'm going to say some special thank yous. My first thank you goes to the parents and the partners and the families and the grandmas that I see here, as well as grandpas. Your support might not always been validated or appreciated, but it definitely makes a very big difference in one's life to be encouraged at a time when things are not always going so well, or when a first exam wasn't doing, when they were not doing so well. And so your formal, informal, financial, and emotional support is very much validated and and I want to acknowledge that. My second big thank you goes to the program team. Pam, as a coordinator, the entire RT team, the faculty, the instructors, the lab technologists, the chair. I know everybody works very, very hard to make sure that the RT students are ready to absorb all of the knowledge and the skills. And then we're incredibly lucky that we have fantastic community partners out there. I just see Jean pop up on the screen as well. We cannot do this without you. And it's because of your commitment to the college that we are able to provide amazing learning opportunities to these students. And so a big thank you for that and for your support and belief that Conestoga College can do a great job. And then lastly, a thank you to you, students. You've done a lot of really, really hard work. Most of us have gone through healthcare programs and degrees and know that it is a lot of learning. It's a lot of anatomy. It's a lot of practicing those skills over and over again. And so that does not come without effort and many long nights and many early mornings. And you've done it. You have really reached the point where you're so very close to graduate and to become our colleagues. And we're incredibly proud of you. And I want to thank you for coming to Conestoga, for working hard with your colleagues and with the program team. And I am really looking forward to see you out there and changing people's lives and influencing quality of care and becoming a leader in your profession. So thank you, congratulations, and back to you, Pam.
Thank you, Veronique. Okay, now I'm happy to introduce you in person to our Chair of Health and Life Sciences, Diana Fong Lee, who just snuck in the back here. Come on up, Diana.
Hi, I see you guys. All look familiar to me, even though you have masks, because I see you. I see you in the elevator. I see you in the agora. It's in the classrooms. You guys are hard workers. So yay, today's a really special day for you. I'm so excited to be a part of it. And just want to say again, along with everyone else, that we're really proud of you. You represent us so well. I've had the opportunity to work with a few of you in different settings or whatever, or some of you look familiar, interprofessional education, you know, workshops, that kind of stuff. So keep it simple. Congratulations today.
Well, thanks, Diana. Over to Tom and Jess. And they're going to talk a little bit and give you an update about the Conestoga Respiratory Therapy Federation, what has happened over the past year. And they're going to talk about their charitable donation, the donation that you guys are making to our ministry house. So come on up, you guys.
So I'm going to start by saying what we accomplished this year. So the CRTF started out with our first event this year, the second annual Robbie Patel. Oh, sorry. The action was pumpkin decorating and trivia night. Secondly, we held our Valentine's Day Candygram fundraiser, where 160 notes of friendship were given out. Between these two events, we were able to raise $130 from our staff and students' participation. In March, the RT students and faculty drank over 1,650 drinks. So we decided what better thing to do than a bottle drive. And through this, we were able to raise another $165 through the hard work of our staff, students, and family. Now, after a bottle drive, Tom and I kind of thought to ourselves, we realized our program liked to hang out and enjoy a beverage. So we thought, with COVID restrictions easing, why not then throw a social night in the middle of exams? But hey, apparently it was what you guys wanted, because we were able to raise another $555 in donations from this event. Now, Gino can vouch for me from the GT final that math is probably not my strongest suit. But thanks to the help of Emily, she has informed me, and I am proud to announce that we have raised $850 this year as a class.
Going to the Lazard and Innisfree House Hospice. And so Lazard and Innisfree House are located in Cambridge and Kitchener, with the Innisfree House being footsteps from campus just on Homer Watson Boulevard there. These homes provide palliative care as well as support for patients and families in the local community. And today we're very fortunate to welcome the executive director for Lazard and Innisfree, Maria Emperingham, to accept our donation. So Maria, the floor is yours if you want to take it.
I just want to start by saying congratulations to all of you. And thank you so much for all your hard work to earn these funds that you can pass on to us. We're so excited about this. These funds will definitely help our residents and our families coming into Lazard and Innisfree, help support their journey through end of life, and help us to give them the best experience. So thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Maria. Yeah, we're so happy to be able to support an essential service here in the community. So now we want to take a few minutes to thank the people that were responsible for helping us achieve the goals that we had this year.
So we're starting off by saying thank you to every CRTF member. We could not have made this year possible without all of your help. We were actually awarded by CSI the most involved club at Conestoga College this year. And that wouldn't have been possible without not only our members, but our students' help. First, I'd like to thank Emily. Thank you for keeping our budget and our donation in order. Otherwise, we probably would not have had a dollar. Vanessa, thank you for promoting all of our events and fundraisers. Without you, it would have been stick figures and word art. To all of our organization and PAC reps, thank you for keeping us in the loop and in communication with our governing bodies. To the first year reps that are attending virtually, thank you for bringing us the first year perspective. We have full faith in handing over the CRTF to you, and know the three of you will do amazing things next year. Lastly, to Tom, thank you for being the best co-president I could have asked for keeping me sane throughout third semester and making sure I never bit off more than I could handle. We have a small gift for all of our CRTF members for you to grab on your way out.
So next, we want to say thank you to Carl. Carl, from the very beginning of the semester, Jess and I knew we would enjoy working with you. It was immediately apparent that we share the same enthusiasm for extracurricular activities and understand how important they are. We had hopes of creating an environment for students to meet each other, explore learning outside of the classroom, have fun, and do something good for a good cause. Despite all of the curveballs thrown at us, and there were many, you helped the CRTF achieve those goals. It was so nice to have you always in our corner, encouraging us along as we navigated obstacle after obstacle. We truly could not have done it without you, and we want to show you our appreciation with a small gift here.
We also have a small token appreciation in here. Yeah.
And a mysterious
cylinder for you to take home.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. That's very kind. Thank you.
next, I get to say some wise words. Pam, I was given the task, sorry, I mean privilege, and thanking you for the past 2 years and all the hoops you've made me jump through. Now, before I begin, I would like to put on record that I wrote a different speech first, realized my bench grade is not finalized yet. Yeah. You're the matriarch of our program and the queen of short answers. Although I cannot speak to your whole time as program coordinator, in the 2 years I've been under your wing, you have handled every obstacle and bump in the road with grace and without hesitation. From moving a whole program online to dealing with an accreditation and still being able to host 8 a.m. breakout rooms with a smile on your face.
You're welcome.
Thank you for teaching me and being a wonderful role model to all of us. We have a small token of our appreciation. You got to keep your mug, and I thought, why not a better than a gift to fill it with?
Hey. More anonymous.
More anonymous. Yes. Thank you. I'm going to need a bigger mug.
No, thank you, everybody.
To share, we thought we'd leave everyone off with some clinical tips by summarizing what we've learned from each instructor. We recommend you write these down and don't forget these for your clinical year. So from Pam, I learned that a baby is not a tiny adult and we shouldn't treat them as such.
And from Pam, I learned that I cannot tolerate 3 hours of neo and peds at 8 a.m.
From Tim, I learned that ventilators are all really the same. They're just packaged differently.
As poor as I think my lungs are, yours are worse.
I learned that 3AA on a tank means it's made of chrome molybdenum. And what's the wall piping made out of?
From Gino, Emily learned that a patient is not a table.
And from Carl, I learned no matter how many times you practice them virtually, stopcocks are tricky.
And from Carl, I learned that I'm intelligent, I intend my best, I'm
human, I make mistakes, but I'm willing to learn.
That's all we've got.
That's good. I learned those things too. Thanks very much, Tom and Jessica, and all the great work. Shout out to the entire CRTF for everything you've done over the last 2 years. It's definitely a pleasure to be here with you today, celebrating your hard work and dedication as you prepare to go off to clinical, embark on the new chapter of your clinical journey, where you'll be seeing lots of me. It's also a terrific way to celebrate the accomplishments of our program as a whole. I am especially honored to be introducing the ProResp Graduate Scholarship Award of Excellence. I know that all of our students are familiar with the award. It's just behind me here, as it is the award that we so proudly display in our respiratory therapy lab. At the end of each clinical year, I extend a call for nominations and ask our clinical partners to think of those students who have gone above and beyond and stand out as constantly motivated, dedicated, responsible, and compassionate for the entirety of the practicum year. Nominations are forwarded by preceptors and clinical associates who have worked directly with those students. This year, we had two outstanding nominees: Jessica Jeeva, who was nominated by Aaron Kiernan and the staff at Southlake Regional Hospital, and Dylan Hawley, who was nominated by Deb Bester and the staff at Grand River Hospital. I'd like to welcome the team from ProResp, including Christine McGregor, John Lefebvre, and Marion Turnbull, as well as Deb Bester, clinical associate at Grand River Hospital. Thank you so much for joining us today for today's award presentation. At this time, I'd like to call upon Christine McGregor to read this year's nomination and present the ProResp Student Award of Excellence to this year's recipient.
Thank you, Jennifer. Just want to make sure that everybody can hear me okay. Is it good? Okay. It is an absolute honor to be able to help to present this award to Dylan this year. What a well-deserving recipient. I read to you today the nomination by Deb Bester. So these are Deb's words, and thank you for inviting me here to help present the award. Dylan has been an exceptional student this year, and he demonstrated all the attributes described for this award. Motivation and initiative. Dylan comes to the hospital every day completely prepared. He takes on all duties assigned to him with a positive attitude and is continuously seeking out opportunities to learn new things. He is always willing to help out his colleagues with any task. Reliability and independence. Dylan is always reliable. He shows up for his shifts early and is always ready to jump in and take on any task. He's able to take on the entire workload, and the staff trust him completely to complete this work accurately and thoroughly. Responsibility and independence. Dylan always assumes responsibility for his patients and his actions. He's able to make a plan for the day and completes this plan. He's able to prioritize his work to ensure that all patients and tasks are completed appropriately and in a timely manner. Cooperation, communication, and attitude. Dylan is able to cooperate with all members of the multidisciplinary team. He is well respected by the staff RTs as well as by the other members of the team. He always acts in a professional manner and is polite. He takes feedback into account and is able to integrate it into his practice to improve upon his skills. Above and beyond all this, Dylan is a kind person who's well liked by patients as well. We had a longer term patient in our ICU who Dylan worked with. This patient slowly improved, and when he got to the point where he was able to speak again, on a trach mask with speaking valve, he asked, "Where's Dylan?" Mm-hmm. Dylan was in a different rotation at this time, but he made a point of visiting the ICU and having a conversation with the patient. I get a little choked up with that. That's amazing. This made the patient extremely extremely happy. These are some of the reasons why Dylan was nominated and ultimately won this award. Congratulations, Dylan.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure working at Grand River under Deb. It was a pleasure going to Conestoga, learning everything that I learned under the amazing faculty that we have there. You know, I wish the best of luck to the second years going into clinical now. You guys will do amazing. Thanks so much.
I'd now like to call upon one of our faculty team members, Tim LePage, to present the CSRT Award for Student Excellence.
Thanks, Jen. We are very fortunate to have Dr. Andrew West with us today. He's joined us virtually. Dr. West is the CEO for the Canadian Society for Respiratory Therapists. And Andrew, if you could present the award to Cassidy Connolly, who is getting the award for Conestoga this year. I think Cassidy is joining us virtually this year.
Excellent.
There she is.
Thank you, Tim. You can hear me?
We can, yes.
Okay, great. It's good to see everyone. Thank you very much. And thanks for welcoming me here today. It's a real honor to be here representing the CSRT and to have the opportunity to say congratulations to all of the students today. What a huge milestone and what a wild couple of years. We know it well, and we're so very proud of all your accomplishments. So the CSRT Award for Student Excellence. So this is the award that recognizes students at each RT education program across the country who demonstrate academic and professional excellence. So this year, I'm really pleased to present this award to Cassidy Connolly. Cassidy is most definitely an exceptional student. She's really demonstrated a passion for the profession, for the RT profession, evidenced through her academic achievement and her many contributions to the Conestoga RT program. She's been a leader and ambassador for the program, acting as an executive member of the Conestoga Respiratory Therapy Foundation and volunteering her time at numerous college fairs and open houses. I hear that she's really impressed her clinical site too, who's also her current employer, with her commitment to clinical excellence. And she was featured actually in a London Health Science Center Facebook post highlighting healthcare workers making a difference. So way to go, Cassidy. You're exceptionally worthy recipient of this award, and we're all very impressed and proud of the way you represent the profession. So on behalf of RTs from all across the country, congratulations on your success, and we really can't wait to see all the places you're going to go.
Thank you so much, and thank you all. Everything that we all do is definitely due to how amazing our professors are, and probably also a lot of alcohol getting through the program. So thanks to all of you guys.
Okay. First, I would like to welcome Paul Pellegrini. Is Paul here today? I think he's maybe in there somewhere. Paul is the executive chairman and founder of Sussex Strategy Group, and he is an OHRS, so Ontario Home Respiratory Services Association representative. May or may not be with us today. That's okay. So let me tell you a little bit about this award. This award is provided by the Ontario Home Respiratory Services Association, and it's given to a student in the respiratory therapy program that demonstrates a desire to enter the home care workplace upon graduation. This year, the award goes to Brennan LaRue. Brennan, I know you're here.
Yep.
There he is. Okay. Good. Hi, Brennan.
Hi, Pam.
Okay, so here is Brennan's award. Yes. Is winning today, but I just thought I would mention that from day one, Brennan established himself as a leader in our program. Having a background already in a healthcare setting as a hearing instrumentation specialist, Brennan tackled the RT program in a very professional manner. He was a supportive classmate who was not afraid to roll up his sleeves to help others when needed. He had a very successful clinical year and had an exceptional home care rotation. So congratulations.
Oh, geez, shucks, Pam, thanks.
All right. Who am I passing off to? I forget. Okay, sorry, Gino. I'm passing off to Gino.
Easily forgot.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, what a great thing. It's been 2 years of online Stethoscope ceremonies and finally to have it in person. I mean, it's been, like Pam said, since 2008. We could recognize past, present, and future at this point in time, right? So students receiving awards that just graduated, presenting awards to some of you here today, and the future of you guys heading off into clinical. So it's always a wonderful day to send you guys off. We are so proud of all of you. You guys are super resilient, super professional. You know, can't say enough about your attitudes and your work ethic. You know, we're sending you off, and you'll do well. We're very, very proud of you, right? So saying that, I'm going to introduce the CSI Award. So past student, Jessica Jiba. She received this award during convocation, which, you know, is now in February, right? February now, right? So, but we didn't have a chance to recognize her at her last Stethoscope ceremony. So Jessica Jiba was a member of the CRTF last year, contributed with the Christmas drive in organizing the gifts for the students, which was really well received, part of the donations, and was a leader in the classroom as well. So we know that she was also nominated for the ProResp Award, so we know she did really well clinically as well, and we're very proud of Jessica, and we want to recognize her today. So congratulations, Jessica.
Thanks, Gino. I feel so honored to be recognized. Hope everyone's doing well.
Thank you, Jessica. All right. So in terms of the present, I think this award only goes to people named Jessica, right? So the other award winner is Jessica Morris, right? So for all her work, again, with in the community, raising money, leading with her purple truck, and then receiving all those bottles. What was the number of bottles?
1,600.
Oh, yes, that's right. So in his greenhouse, I know it's been...
I know.
has received donations from us for the past few years, and I know it's means something to a few of us within the faculty, having loved ones spending time there. So I know it's up to you guys in terms of who you donate to, but it's always a really worthy cause. So Jessica showed leadership throughout the program, always with a smile and positive attitude and good sense of humor and always willing to work hard. So we're very proud of Jessica, and thank you with working for Tom, and very appreciative of you winning the CSI award. Present students is the TD Interprofessional Award, right? So we want to recognize Tom Gibson for this award. He, from the start of the program, has shown very strong leadership. I remember the first day meeting him at the barbecue and just talking about how excited he was to be in the program, right? Involved in interprofessional events, like with our paramedic interprofessionals, so that you guys all participate, but, you know, Tom took a leadership role in that and you know, ensuring the paramedics had a pretty good understanding of what RTs do at the bedside. So all his work, again, with CRTF, leading that cause with Jessica, and we're very proud to have Tom receive this award, and he does exude excellence in interprofessional education. So congratulations, Tom. Now I'm handing off to Jen.
Carl, actually.
No.
We have these new ones. Yeah. Pretend there are new ones here.
So, maybe we'll just go back one slide. So this year I had the unique privilege of taking on the role of faculty advisor for the CRTF. I mean, Gino has been in this role for a long time, but he did a sabbatical completing his Master of Education. And I just feel very privileged to have been in that role. So I learned some really great recognitions just yesterday related to, you know, the CSI recognizing CRTF as being one of the most involved clubs, which is just absolutely amazing. And they recognized both Jessica and Tom as being the most involved co-presidents in the club. So that's just... You know, it's a testament to the leadership when you look at the club's activities. Like, this pandemic has been unprecedented, as you know, for creating lockdowns, for just trying to really squash any opportunity to try to get together. And there's a ton of clubs that folded, were unable to. But this club persevered, and I just think that's just amazing. So we just really wanted to recognize, on behalf of the program, we wanted to recognize that we're pleased and proud of you. And we'd like to Jessica Morris and Tom Gibson come up to share these placeholders. Now I think I'm going to pass it on.
Thanks so much, Carl. So each year, Conestoga Rec recognizes outstanding employers and students at a recognition awards event in March. Select employers are chosen by alumni, corporate training, Conestoga Career Center, cooperative education, and work integrated learning are recognized along with co-op and WILL Students of the Year. This year, I'm very excited that the respiratory therapy program was recognized in both categories, which is unheard of. This year's Will Student of the Year was selected for his outstanding clinical performance, as well as his contributions to interprofessional simulation events here at Conestoga College. And I'd like to add that this came from 5 individual nominations for this award. So my congratulations, our congratulations goes out to Brennan LaRue.
Thank you, everyone.
Second, this year's host organization award goes to a very long time clinical partner of our program. They were recognized for their support of clinical students, especially during those challenges faced in community care as the pandemic evolved. They remained committed to work placements, student education, and providing very important community clinical experiences to ready our students for entry to practice. Congratulations goes out to ProResp.
Thank you, everybody.
Back over to Carl to present the awards of recognition.
Thanks, John. So as I mentioned before, I feel very privileged to be the faculty advisor this year for the CRTF, and it was very humbling to be able to work with this group of very young and energetic individuals. I really believe that professionalism and that engaged positive culture starts here, and I'm just very, so on behalf of the program, we're very proud of you, very impressed and thankful for your achievements, and we want to recognize you for that. So please come up as we call you. We'll start with the next slide. We'll call you by name. So Jessica. All right. Jeff.
Was well with enthusiasm, even when that well was nearly dry. Somehow Jess kept the fire of motivation lit and helped to engage the first years in her very unique way. And if ever you need to negotiate for anything, you want Jessica on your team. So on behalf of the RT program, we are thankful and recognize you as the co-president of CRTF.
Thanks, Carl.
And Tom is all about fairness, inclusiveness, and, you know, I think if we say in sailing, just keeping an even keel, right? And keeping the eye on the prize. In the end, Tom wanted everyone just to have fun and kept that messaging on point all year. This program proudly recognizes Tom Gibson, co-president, CRTF.
Thank you.
Points and minutes. And not only did Emily keep a balanced ledger down to the penny, but with a keen ear, managed to somehow distill the chaos of the meetings into actually really concise minutes every week. So without that, the club would be lost. So thank you. This program proudly recognizes the contributions of Emily DiLeonardo as treasurer of the CRTF. As for Vanessa. Creative approach to messaging was on point via Instagram, Facebook, and probably some other social media engines. I have no idea of it. So she gave the club visibility, profile, connectedness, and kept the membership informed throughout the year. So this program proudly recognizes the contributions of Vanessa Kuhn as the social media exec for the CRTF.
stay connected to this national association, its activities and events. Haley smiled at every meeting, even when things were tough. And she was kind of like the litmus test for reason for decisions. If Haley approved of an idea, it was probably a good idea. So this program proudly recognizes the contributions of Haley Simon as CSRT rep for the CRTF.
Thank you.
And same connectedness with the National Association for the CRTF. Sujith also smiled at every meeting. He was an idea generator or a catalyst for ideas, and I believe was the originator of the idea back to the Bring Back the Airways Olympics, although Ravi's might kind of dispute that, but it was an excellent thing, and we had a terrific Olympics. So the program proudly recognizes the contributions of Sujith Basanthakumar.
Yes.
On up. Events and opportunities available through the provincial organization. And Wesley attended each meeting with quiet conviction. He was a reliable team player and enabler for many of the CRTF generated initiatives. This program proudly recognizes the contributions of Wesley Tron as RTS. Did I get it? As RTSO rep for CRTF. Thank you. All right. Committee student representative in providing that all important student perspective during those meetings. Her sense of objectivity, pragmatism, and reason suited her well for this role. And during CRTF meetings, her logic and reason helped keep the club moving towards its goals. And she also has a very subtle sense of humor, which you would deploy with this uncanny timing. And it would make you think, haha. RT Program Advisory Committee student rep on the CRTF. Not Vanessa's sister, this is Vanessa. Again, she wears many hats, and one of those was serving as a peer tutor. Vanessa has been very engaged with first years with group and one-to-one tutorials, as well as creating tests, quizzes, questions, just helping prep the first years for success. So given it's a sort of a separate and distinct hat and role, it's worthy of its own recognition. This program is proudly recognized as the contributions of Vanessa Kuhn as the RT peer tutor.
Good. So I have the honor now of introducing you to our keynote speaker this year. And he's a very entertaining individual, as you will soon find out. When I asked him a few days ago, a week or so ago, I asked, you know, Danny, would you mind just sending a few words for your bio so that it could introduce you properly? And these are the words that he sent, in his words, of course. Danny is an RRT with several years experience. Graduating in 1997 from the Queen Elizabeth II School of Allied Health, had worked at the Queen Elizabeth Health Science Center from 1997 to 2003. In brackets, he says, he asks that you do not do the math or share the year that you were born. In 2003, he started at St. Mary's General Hospital, where he's worked as an RRT, he's worked as an AA, he's been the professional practice lead, and several years ago moved into a program manager role. He's currently the program manager, respiratory therapy, airway clinics. He is also the innovation lead, Department of Strategy, Innovation, and Communication. Danny is actively involved in the profession, sitting at various levels locally, provincially and nationally. He currently serves as the chair of the Canadian Board for Respiratory Care Exam Committee. So he, you want to be on Danny's good side, okay? All right, welcome, Danny.
Thank you.
Everybody. It's like the ones that work. Perfect. ERT profession, and I see many people, I see families, but I also see coworkers on the screen, and they'll appreciate this as well as the faculty. What I'd like to do now is welcome you to the family, okay? It is a profession, it is a job, it is a career. It is a team you will join, but more importantly, you'll actually join the ERT family. Many of these folks on the screen, we can reach out to, we can ask for favors, and we can get them just like that. Whether it's our partners down the hospital, or about down the street with Grand River Hospital, whether it's our home care communities, I see Jean and Christine on there, whether it's Andrew at the national level, or even coworkers or classmates that I used to work with going back many, many years now. Okay. So when Pam and Gino asked me to come today, they wanted me to talk a little bit about what the last 2 years have been. And I'm not here to scare you. What I want to do is give you a realistic version of kind of what you're walking into, but also want to wrap up with some things so you guys can be better prepared, not just for your clinical year, but to be clinicians throughout your entire career. Okay. So what feels like our 99th wave of the pandemic, because in most of this world, every 2 weeks seems to be another wave or another wave or another wave, okay? You guys had the unbridled privilege of going through every transition from starting at home to a little bit of work, now being back on site. We've gone through all those changes at the hospital as well. I will ask you to count your blessings, though, as you go into a hospital in the middle of a pandemic. You were not that first class. I remember the shock and awe and fear on that first group of four that came when we reopened clinical practices in the early part of 2020. And I was one of those ones that at our hospital lobbied to get the students back in because we knew what we were facing. We knew how well the students were being trained, and we knew if we could survive that first 1 or 2 months of clinical practice, you were going to be, the students coming on site were going to be a huge access or advantage to us and not a detriment. So thank you for that. Okay. So what has the last 2 years been? Well, it's been hard. We've gone through all kinds of different challenges. PPE, oh my goodness, you would have had to use a roadmap 2.5 years ago to find an N95 mask around the hospital. Nowadays, you don't go anywhere without your equipment. Okay. AGMPs, that's another word, kind of like continuing education, best practice that a lot of us aren't going to want to hear for the next 10 to 20 years. And I know in a lot of places, there was myths. There was tons of misunderstanding. When you have non-clinicians trying to argue with an RT about what an aerosol-generating procedure is, we shook our head and we smiled. And I'll use the word, the stupidity. And I don't mean it detrimental, but it was people who did not have the knowledge that were trying to tell those who did. And that was a lot of our first few months of this. It's like, just calm down. We'll get through this. It is a respiratory disease. We are your experts. We will help you. We'll help navigate this. Okay. In the early days, you can't do that. Oh my goodness. You have to intubate everyone. You cannot do a hypoxia. You cannot do non-invasive ventilation. Oh my God, you might generate an aerosol. It's okay. We have this lovely stuff called protective equipment for that. So we survived that. And then we got to the point where they went from, you can't do that, to, oh my God, we should have did that. Yeah, we were telling you that. And then behind the scenes, we kind of did it without telling them what we were doing. Like, you can't let that patient breathe on their own. Yeah, they've been doing it for the last 2 days. You didn't notice. And the other part that really came at us was the volume of work. And I can tell you, in all my years, I have never seen workload like we have seen the last 2 years. Fortunately, and hopefully for you guys, as we're coming in, we're on the downside of roller coaster. We're going to see peaks and valleys. But that first year was the highest I think any of us have ever seen.
We had patients in every nook and cranny of hospitals, and I literally meet them. We were opening spaces faster than we could figure out what to do with them. I still have maps in my office of where else we could put a ventilated patient. Chances are, if it had a medical error anywhere near, we were going to look at using it. A lot of it I started with one more, there's a couple of pop-ups. Tim? Most of your families, and probably some of you guys, a year or two before you got into the profession, is what the heck is an RT? Nobody knew who an RT was. If you introduce yourself at a meeting or an event, you said you're a respiratory therapist, you either get, what's that? Or, ah. And if you got, ah, you knew they had a sick family member at some point in the past. I remember a few months ago, it was somebody, their child was in McMaster Hospital for an amount of time. Like, you're an RT? Oh my God. I wish I was applying for a loan at the time because I could have got the paper signed right there. Just basically. But by 3 months in, 6 months in, 12 months in, we went from what is an RT to, oh my God, you're the RT, thank you. And that was everywhere. That was our intensive care units. That was our operating rooms. That was our medical floors. And we opened a lot of them. So we essentially increased the inpatient capacity at our hospital by 25%. Majority of people that we hired were brand new nursing students, fresh out of school, no clinical experience. What are we gonna do? It's like, we can help. So we were actually able to support those areas with RTs and became very valuable part of that, okay? So what are some of the good things that we've done over the last couple of years? Well, our teams. And this is where I say teams and I mean our family. We were tight before, and you guys know that being from even a larger class. Again, I heard enough of the stories that it's there. I can tell you your work partners are that much more of a family. And we got very close, a lot because we spent a lot more time together. Our casuals were working overtime hours, our full-time, everybody was there. But you were each other's emotional support, and that was great. Okay? You're also you're everybody's clinical experience. Well, what if we do this? There was a lot of them. Okay. The family grew, and that was good for people looking for work and past people, but it was required from the amount of workload going on. So at one point we had two ICUs. We essentially expanded that to a third. Almost every other hospital in all of Ontario added beds and spaces that were unbeknownst to them that they could even attempt to use. For us, we went up significantly on days and more importantly at nights. We used to have a skeleton staff at night that one or two sick patients would occupy everybody's time. Well, I can tell you for almost 2 years, every single night, we had very complex, very sick patients that occupied a lot of time. Okay. The continuing educations were met, no problem. And I say that this is the leader in the past professional practice. When you walk out and you want to talk about continuing education, do you need this? I don't want to talk about the in-service. I'm not joining that. Those people that you couldn't get to show up in in-service if you brought their coffee and a muffin and sat them in the front row were the ones calling, what about this? What about this? I read this. I did this. So it got RTs that have been practicing and a little bit complacent really back involved in research and updating their continuing education because we had to. There was no ability for everybody to wait to be spoon-fed. They had to bring that back on their own. And I think that was a very good thing for the profession. Equipment, oh my goodness. And I say this in a few different ways. So our hospital is very lucky. There was a large private donor that supported local hospitals here in the city. And we pretty much wiped out our entire capital equipment request list. So usually I ask for things and about 5 to 8 years later, if it doesn't break down beforehand, we might get some funding to replace it. I don't have anything left on my capital equipment list because some very, very, generous donors in the region, it came in and anything that they said, we're here to help. Anything to do with respiratory or COVID, we're here, use this money. And it's great. Now I'm tripping over equipment when we're a little bit quiet, but we're still at the point where we're down to the last one off. You start to panic. The other part of equipment is actually relying on your family. Very early on, we thought we were gonna run out of ventilators. Well, I happen to know, being a past faculty here and lab instructor, where there's a very big supply of ventilators. I knew where there was gladscopes. I knew where there was all kinds of things. And with some simple phone calls, we were able to reach out and with the tractor, my wife's SUV, delivered all those equipment back to the hospital and readied them for use. Okay. So without that, we would have been pulling equipment that we may not have known who had it, where it was from. We knew exactly where it was. We knew it was being used. We knew it was maintained in a good state. Okay. So the other good, expanded roles. And this has been more the last year. Once we kind of get over the acute side and we get over the ICU side, we start to learn that there's a lot of care that are going to be involved with these patients. You start hearing word now about long COVID. I think we've almost set all of you up for your careers and probably dealing with patients with long-term lung disease. Even if we wipe out smoking and everything else, probably COVID has probably created enough disease that are going to keep you guys busy for the rest of your careers. That's the good and the bad. The good news was we did so well as an RNT profession in the early days, they started reaching out, looking for new things. A few months ago, they said, COVID has a resurgence. We don't have the staff. We don't have the extra spaces we did. Our emergency departments can't handle it. We're going to start up a clinic. Your airway clinic is right next to the emergency department. Makes sense. I said, absolutely. In fact, I'll give you the RTs. No, we have other help. I said, I will give you my RTs. By day two, it was thank you for giving us your RTs. We are actually continuing to expand and support that clinic, treating patients that are presenting with exacerbations of COVID, helping them navigate the antiviral stream and trying to get therapy over the hospital. Research came out very quickly into a small hospital that is hard. Our research is not supported, but we were able in the early days to actually partner with some folks and actually did some very good research that hopefully may come out to help support detecting viruses like this or other ones down the line. Okay. The other big thing was actually hoping long-term, this is actually translates into better staffing for us long-term to better resource those areas that we were struggling with before. I think in our hospital for sure, we had a very good recognition for our RTs in the inpatient, and a few of our inpatient areas, our ICUs and our emergency departments, when they would call the RT. There's a lot of new staff, had no idea what it was. I can tell you most of those places, their first step is they call an RT for absolutely everything, which is good and bad, but the recognition isn't there. Okay. We've actually totally changed our education that now the RTs are actually involved in general nursing education, trying to, instead of having an educator teach what we do, we are now teaching what we do, what diseases, how to manage things, and how to navigate things at our hospital. Now, the bad, and I'm not here to scare you with this. I just want to talk about what is realistic and to let you know you're going to be going in and dealing with some of these staff members that have been going through this routine. The change in uncertainty over the last 2 years has been beyond. Okay. And as RTs, as you've seen, and we've talked about it here, we're good innovators, we're great at adapting, and you can do that for days, weeks, a couple of months. You're hitting 24, 25, 26 months, it starts to wear. And when I'm talking change in uncertainty, many times I showed up at 7:30 and said, okay, here's the situation, here's the plan. Oh, it's 9:15. Here's a new situation. Here's the plan. 1 o'clock. Oh, it's changed again. And we don't have a plan. What do you think we should do? And this went on days and weeks and months and started to wear on. So we're to the point where those big spikes kind of went like the COVID trends. And we're getting in there. We're not getting that uncertainty because we've done this before now over 2 years. Last time we did this, this worked. Last time we did that, that didn't work. So let's do something different. So we're taking out some of that change and that uncertainty. But that had a lot of impact on the staff. And you'll see that when you go. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. You will see that on some of the faces. However, and we kind of talked about it over time, that wore people down. And the picture at the bottom left of the screen, I think, summarizes what the last 2 years looked like in healthcare. Okay. The bottom right is what we used to think was a good healthcare professional. You were that rock. First years in the room, I don't want to give away anything. No?
There's some I've
learned. Okay. So some of you probably went through a lab situation in the last year. We put you in a very difficult emotional state. Years ago, we were taught you to be that rock. I'm there, I'm stoic, I'm very calm, I'm reassuring. And I grew up in that generation where I thought that was the right way to be. I can tell you, A, my mind changed when I had kids, but my mind has definitely changed over the last 2 years. Okay? What I would encourage you to be is not be that rock. I want you to be that marshmallow that feels, that squeezes, that adapts and changes and reflects that environment you're around. Okay? Anyone know what that rock is in that picture? I'm a good East Coaster, so that is a rock that has been in the Bay of Fundy for years with the highest tides. I chose that rock for a reason. Last year, the tides were up and going so much, that rock no longer exists. It actually got wiped out. And I think that was a pretty good metaphor for where I think that mentality of that solid rock, I don't feel anything, goes. I want you to think about being that kind, considerate, show your emotion kind of practitioner. Sorry, that was a hard one for me. So what did we learn? We learned all kinds of medically. I can tell you as a leader, mind changed. I can support everybody with a clinical practice, keeping up to date on what our skills are, everything else. But the last probably 6 to 12 months has not been, how do we ventilate COVID patients? Do we do OmniFlow? Do we do this? It's how do I support the staff, my coworkers, my peers, and coming into it, you guys, okay? Because you're coming into this environment. And for years, the elephant, especially that first year, year and a half, the elephant in the room was people's mental health. We said, yeah, it's hard on people, it's hard on people, it's hard on people. Well, you can do that for a month. You can do it for 2 months. 6 months, you started out with that. Some people started cracking up, oh, sick time's a problem. I'm gonna talk to that staff member. Maybe we find out why they're sick. Are they sick physically? Are they COVID? Or do they need some time mentally? Okay. So for good or bad, I personally hit a wall about a year and a half, or about a little over a year ago. We had constant outbreaks. I was managing an inpatient unit, which was the COVID designated floor in our building. And after the third or fourth wave, where I'd had almost 20 or 30 staff members who got positive, whether through social exposures or work, we'll never know. It started to hit me because I was making phone calls, such and such is positive. I would call them, how are you? What can I do? And I got to the point where we had an agency staff who started 3 weeks ago, who was 35 weeks pregnant, who I had no idea was even pregnant until the COVID, or employee health and wellness called me and said, I got bad news, such and such is pregnant, and they have COVID. And I lost it. That was it. I put my head on my desk and I cried because I could not make that phone. And I started to stand up and my phone again. So one of my nursing staff, who I'd known for almost all of 18, 19 years I've been at St. Mary's, I knew her mother had lymphoma, was undergoing chemo and radiation. I was worried about that was the one person I didn't want to hear from. And I got the call that her daughter, my staff member, was positive. I knew her mother lived with her, and I could not make that phone call. What I did, I was in the middle of a call. When I got that one with our senior team, I put my head on my desk and cried because I couldn't make it. And for good or bad, our president of our hospital ran to my room, put her arm around me, and we cried together for that. And that was my opening moment. And my focus for the next little bit was not how to ventilate that COVID patient at 40 right now. RTs who can do that, sorry, it's okay. But it was all about supporting their mental health from that point forward. And that's been most of my focus for the last year, okay? So, we gave them the staffing they needed. We reassigned people, we overstaffed on purpose. We gave them those supports. We increased our mental health supports. And those are little things. So we instituted a care card every Friday. senior leaders take a cart full of candy and chocolate and salts, and we roam the building and just say thank you. What can we do? Hand out mental health cards. This afternoon, first time back, there's a room full of puppies literally at the hospital. People sign up in half hour intervals to go down and play with the puppies. We started going from penalizing people for being off sick to encouraging people to take a sick day. You're clearly struggling, take the day. We started assigning those times off. Okay. What we did is we started to take this badness and turn it into the good one and actually change the whole culture of the hospital to be more supportive in these issues. Okay. At the end of the day, I try and lead by example. Years ago, I would have hit it. I was that solid one. I think the best thing I did on that day that I lost it, I went to my care areas and started to tell them that I was leaving because I mentally could not do it anymore. And I remember going to the inpatient chest unit, one of the staff, like they said, no, we're fine. And I just stopped and I said, you're not fine because I am not fine. You are frontline with this. There is no way you're fine. And started opening and breaking down those doors. Okay. So why am I telling you all this? And it's not to scare you. It's not to make you sad. It's not to make you scared. It's to recognize we're not all experts in this, but I want you to start thinking about that as the next skill that you need to develop as you go into clinical. Okay. We've taught you chest assessments. We've taught you blood gas. We've taught you ventilator waveforms, or at least we better have Tim. So we've simulated everything, but this is the one thing we can't really simulate. Okay. This is the one you're gonna have to learn kind of on your own, but we're there to support you with it. Okay. One more, Jim, I think. So what I learned, prevention is a cure. Okay. There is no magic treatment for everybody. What worked for me will not work for you, will not necessarily work for you, won't work for everyone. Okay. The key, what I want you to think about, especially as you go into the clinical, you're going to be going extra stressful because you have graduation that depends on this. You're going under extra stress. You've already lived through 2 years of the stress. Now you're going in. Not only your stress, you're going to be working beside people who are feeling this. What I want you to do is recognize that you're feeling those stresses, okay? Be your advocate. So I am doing much better at asking staff and trying to promote it. But at the end of the day, you folks have to be your advocate and say, I need help. I need support with this, okay? Know what resources you have out there, okay? And you have a ton. There is 1-800 numbers everywhere. Their school has programs, for sure. Our hospital has programs. The students that are on placement at our hospital are encouraged to actually reach out to those, okay? You have them. There is a ton of free things, whether they be downloadable apps, about minus, about centering, whatever it is, look out for them, okay? If you need to find a support, find a clinician that can help you with that. The key is find something that works for you. I used to ask a question about what do you do for stress relief during a job interview to try and see if someone had that activity. I can tell you, I listened much more intently to the answers to that question over the last year because I know you're under a lot more stress than we've ever seen. Okay. And the other thing I encourage you to do is continue to lobby for those extra supports because at some point you're going to go from that student to the staff member. And what I want you to do is as you go through, lobby it, and that's necessarily for yourself. Look around the room and think about that for each one of your peers. Okay. These are your new family. You're going into work with other family, but start thinking of that. Okay. If you do nothing else for me, start thinking about what you're going to be and what kind of clinician you're going to be. I strongly encourage you not to be that rock, to be that marshmallow, to be that person that will sit down in the hallway and cry with the peer, that'll hold their hand, that'll support them through that hard time. Okay. Don't pat them on the head and say it'll be okay and move on. We've all learned over the last few years that's not. Okay. So the last one, and not here to, I don't want to depress you with that. I want to lean on because what I want you to do is the RTs are already the super people of the hospital. Okay. One end out, call the RT. That is the motto at most hospitals. What I want you to do is you guys can do even more than that. Yes, we can save the life. Yes, we can stabilize the patient. Going forward, maybe there's a new superpower out there because you do roam the building. You're going to be in some of the highest stress areas out there. Maybe you can be that new superpower as being that mental health advocate as well. Okay. Thank you.
Thank and great conversation. Thank you very much. From all of us, faculty, all of you, students, everyone at home, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. You guys have been sitting line up. Time for your oath. So here's how this works. You see the white paper in front of you? Did you all memorize this before? Okay, no? What you're gonna do, you're gonna take your stethoscope off your neck. You're gonna hold it in your hand. You're gonna come to the front of the room and you're gonna do this oath together with your classmates. Okay? You can bring it with you. So come on up. Come on up.
If you want to make your way so we can see you on the camera, for all your family, to see you guys. You guys are going to see it on the floor, and then put the stethoscope over your head. How's the camera?
You have to do it perfect the first time, or else you have to do it over and over again. No. Are you ready?
Interprofessional healthcare team. I will respect my level of competence and seek additional knowledge when the required level of care is beyond my abilities. I understand this to be a lifelong journey and will constantly strive to improve my skills and broaden my knowledge. I am proud to promote my profession with pride and enthusiasm. I make this commitment to my profession and to my patients freely and in good faith.
Slideshow presentation for you. So the CRTF led by Vanessa did a great job putting all of these together and some of the memories of things that we've been through the last 2 years. So enjoy.
And on three, Airway Olympics. One, two,
we staying
three.
In Paris. And I thought, wow, if I could take this in a shot right now, I don't
don't think that we could work this out on a terrace. I don't know if it's fair, but I thought, how could I let you fall by yourself? Well, I'm wasted for someone else. If we go down, then we go down together. They'll say you could do anything, they'll say that I was clever. If we go down, then we go down together. We'll get away with everything.
Let's show them we are better.
Let's show them we are better. Let's show them we are better. We're staying in Paris. Get away from your parents, you look so proud. Standing there with a frown and a cigarette, posting pictures of yourself on the internet, out on the terrace. We breathe in the air of this small town, on our own, cutting glass with the thrill of it. Getting drunk on the past we were living in. If we go down, then we go down together. They'll say you could do anything, they'll say that I was clever. If we go down, then we go down together. We'll get away with everything. Let's show them we are better.
Let's show them we are. Show them we are. Show them we are. Show them we are.
Let's show them we are better. We're staying in power.
Hello, SRT, soon to be RRTs. It's Gino.
It's Sam.
It's Carla.
It's Pam here.
It's been an absolute pleasure teaching you, and we've truly seen you grow so much since day one.
Although we wish we could spend more time together, always cherish the little black boxes with your name, letting us know you came to lecture.
It has been a rocky year for us all, but you guys have truly managed to show us that diamonds form best under pressure.
We just want to say, enjoy your clinical, and most importantly, keep in touch.
Keep in touch.
Keep in touch.
We were staying in Thailand.
Family-wise or whatever friends we can share with them too.